we are trying to deal with also within the context of habitats. Because I think each of our centers and their concerns, for example, we talk about housing, we talk about urban environments, we talk about global environments, right, in the context of climate change, or if we talk about water, all of these are aspects which deal with very, very crucial resources such as land, water, air, and their treatment sometimes is common, sometimes is public goods, sometimes is private goods, very changing context of the regulations which govern them, and the entire, I think, changing role of different institutions within society as well. Where does society come up? Where does the, and how do we begin to define the state itself? How is that state taken within society? What are the roles that the state takes on? And then if we begin to think about its partnerships and the role with the private sector itself, within the context of India itself, one has to also ask, what is the private sector? Is the private sector only formal, registered, large, corporate, corporates? Is it something which also has to do with the innumerable, I would say, small, unregistered, unorganized kind of forms of entrepreneurial initiatives that we see flooded everywhere? And is public-private partnership really something which is an extremely new concept? As an urbanist, if I reflect upon the history of Mumbai, there have been several key pieces of infrastructure in Mumbai. Like if you look at public wells in the old city of Mumbai, if one looks at the major roads which have been constructed, like the LJ Road in Manipur, Bandra, these are all examples where the private sector has teamed up with the state sector and initiated items of infrastructure. The first municipal school in the city of Mumbai was one where it was a building which was constructed by one of the philanthropists in Mumbai, who run in debt hospices even now, and it is a municipal school. So I think there have been a whole lot of histories of associations between the public and the private sector. We need to acknowledge both of these and are part of society itself. So what we are discussing at the current juncture is really an evolution of roles. And perhaps evolution is a bad term here, because it really kind of assumes a certain kind of unilateral trajectory. But what I would say is really that we are at a juncture where there is a particular posturing, a particular situating of both of these sectors in relation to each other. And from that point of view, the concept of public itself also is getting transformed. So I would really situate it, this kind of a workshop at that juncture. And I think then all the questions, Jasmine, therefore, that you asked about what is the public, right? What is the private, how do we redefine it, are there, or should this be defined only for classical economic kind of discipline, or is there a requirement of a new redefinition of what is a public good itself, and recasting the roles of the public in the what are then the roles of new evolving roles of the state in the context of these difficulties, and is the state capable of even fulfilling these roles? As a concept, globally, if we begin to see with the both the sustainable development goals as well as the habitat conference which was held last year, one sees that the international agencies have very much adopted PPP as part of an overall strategization. Achieve SDGs, to move towards climate change, or to realize all the goals which are linked to a more sustainable urban world, as is called within the entire habitat. So when we talk about such a huge kind of mandate given to people, understanding their evolving forms within the context of different countries becomes a huge challenge. And I think it's important to know, because one sees globally that it is largely the UK and the USA which have in some ways pioneered the entire concept of PPPs. They have also fairly in terms of looking at what their impacts are within the context of these countries. And I think within the developing world, I mean, seeing sectors within which they started, there are several sectors even now where you do not see PPPs. And perhaps when we come to the housing question, I will raise a question about what we are calling PPPs. Are they really PPPs? So that's something that's so to be asked. So I leave it there because I think it's an extremely provocative subject. It's a very important subject and something which crosses multiple lines, is linked to very vital questions before humanity and before therefore we need to engage with this debate and perhaps take it.
I took the plans to be included in the first session because I wanted to share my understanding of PPP. Of course, from my own disciplinary perspective, in continuation with what Ranjal was mentioning in his opening remark, possibly, you know, beyond economics, I don't have much understanding of other disciplines, but I do understand the limitation of my discipline and how to bring all other disciplines to develop a holistic understanding of emerging unity. I will take some time to situate my argument, my understanding, I'm taking a risk, because I'll try to locate my argument within Elaine's structure, right? And I wish Elaine were here and we could engage into a debate, but this is the risk that I'm taking, that I'll try to understand Elaine from my own disciplinary perspective. To begin with, a bit of recapitulation very quickly. The concept of public good, private good began with Paul Samuelson's 1954 article. And if we go strictly by his definition, then there's a clear demarcation between public good and private good. Public good is a clear case of market failure, so the state has to provide. And private good would be delivered by the private sector within a market setup. But gradually, the distinction has been found to be really untenable, it's blurred, because we see an increasing private participation. So which are the pure public goods? There are very few, in fact. In fact, I was wondering last night whether defense can be also outsourced to a private party. And, you know, we can do, I mean, what is really a public good, therefore, if we go strictly by Samuelson's definition? So what difference does it make if we ask the private sector to deliver what was exclusively being within the confinement of the public sector? And there are a couple of developments. I believe, if I may just recall, the definition, non-rivalry and non-excludability. And non-excludability follows from non-rivalry. So the excludability has been challenged because of the development in the IT and the legal framework. So you can make somebody excludable. So a pure public good can be converted to a private good. And that is how I believe the emerging scenario can be explained to an extent. That this, because we can bank on technology, we can frame the rules and regulations, and the public good, hitherto a public good, could be converted to a private good. Now, let me therefore get back to Elaine's conceptualization, and then I situate with some examples how this particular framework, and this is what I thought yesterday after dinner and today morning. So please, there could be some conceptual errors in the process. Elaine is trying to reformulate the debate, public good, common good, and private good, under three different formulations. So let me begin with the first, the causation idea. In the causation idea, the idea is about that it is trying to legitimate the role of the private sector and PPP. Why? Because private sector can deliver certain outcomes which are predefined. So there is no distinction between private and the public. If the private sector can enhance, can contribute to the capital formation, human capital formation in education and health and infrastructure, and it would enhance the condition of the common good, then it is actually legitimating the PPP, right? And therefore they are linked with the particular outcomes. Now, I think then this is here, the entire argument about why PPP and why should we invite the private sector can be located. And that is actually a neoliberal kind of argument, which originates from two dimensions of the state failure. One is the state is handicapped with the resource constraint, the FRBM fiscal responsibility and budget management act. We have seen in the last 2.5 decades, since 1991, state has felt circumscribed by its inability to devote adequate resources to the social sector. And the second is the governance failure, or what we call government failure or poor governance. Now, because of this, there's an argument that you bring the private sector in and private sector can equally contribute to what the government was either contributing, and that is legitimating the public-private partnership. But this assumption that the government doesn't have resources and the government is intrinsically doomed to fail in its delivery, that is the corruption, malpractices, or overall the poor governance, the assumptions behind all these things are really questionable. And they're questionable particularly in a country context and the sector-specific context. So we have to understand this. The second is a very interesting one, the conditional idea. In the conditional idea, what is being argued here, that private sector can really contribute to education, health, and infrastructure, but under certain conditions. And which are those conditions? Conditions are, there are certain contextual conditions and certain conditions which pertain to the functioning, right? So this conditional support being extended to the private participation and public-private partnership has to be understood in a country context, because how does the state respond and what are the different forms of inequality just being referred to, which are important, which are of paramount significance in a particular country context. Now, when I'm looking at what Elaine is saying, certain conditions and certain context, I was thinking that there are different dimensions to this. And what are those dimensions that I can figure out from my own discipline? Number one is the quality. When you are talking about whether the private sector can really come in and contribute, there are two questions. One is the access, which is the major focus of our network. And second is the quality. Will the private sector deliver the same quality what public was delivering earlier, right? Or together. Now here, a very important distinguishing feature when you are looking at the various sector would be the role of technology. If there is a technology, then and the quality of the product or the service could be precisely defined, then the private sector participation would not really raise doubt or would not face any steep resistance, because the clientele, we would feel private sector doing a job which was as good as what was being done by the public sector. Like, you know, Air India being privatized. You know, as I'm flying from Delhi to Mumbai, there is no difference between, because the same aircraft, same other thing, there will be some marginal peripheral changes in the service, but in terms of the quality, it is very precisely defined. So, but when you're looking at education and health in particular, there is no such technology which can convert the input to the output. And therefore, in this particular education and health, the process is very, very important, right? Second is the, what is the role of the consumer? As a flyer from Delhi to Mumbai, I can exactly assess what is the quality of the service being delivered by recently privatized Air India. It's a utopian scenario, but may not be utopian for long, but I'm just saying. But for education and health, when you're looking at the clients, the consumer, we have to understand that the students and the patients may suffer from information asymmetry. They may suffer from, as most of us do, bounded rationality. That means they may not be in a position to assess what is being delivered. And here lies the role of the private sector, that whether the students and the patients can be taken for a ride or they can be misled by the private sector. The role of the consumers and their participation, their voice, would therefore greatly dilute it. It happens in case of education, I can tell you, because in education, when the quality is being co-constructed, that means the teachers and the students are jointly producing a quality of the product, and students can very often be lured by the private sector. Why? Because it's the certificate which matters. The process can be somehow be subverted, or there could be several aspects of improprieties which are associated with the processes, right? And this privatization of education, therefore, the students would be happy, but we may not be sure about the quality of education that is being delivered. And students would be happy at the end of the day because they are the co-constructor of this teaching learning outcome. The third, which has already been mentioned by Jasmine, is the motive, the private sector. So why Elaine is talking about suffering condition? Because the condition may differ and it can evolve over a period of time. Because the private sector motive is very important. It is philanthropic, it is commercialization, and here lies the importance of this financial balancing condition, that whether the private sector would find it to be profitable or find it to be economically justifiable or financially justifiable to pump in money and to sustain the services. And when, therefore, this is connected with the role of the state, the government, when the government is engaged with the private sector, there could be various forms, there could be various mode of engagement, mode of partnership. And for each of these partnership, the implication for the private sector, the implication for the public and quality and access, all these are extremely amazing, a very complicated kind of situation. So the mode of engagement is very, very important because that will reflect the intention of the state towards society in a particular sector, and how does the private sector intervene and what does the private sector do when after getting into this partnership. Now here again, I would not give the details of it, that this private sector participation in certain sectors like education and care are problematic because the very notion of efficiency is not tenable. There is a link between cost and quality. So that if the cost and quality are linked, and then we are supposed to be accessing to something common which is equal. Common good means it is not only about equality, it is also equalizing access to something very equal, right? So if something very equal, then there's a problem with the private sector because they may resort to cost cutting and compromise with the quality, and malpractices can abound. And the third dimension, third aspect, reformulation of Elaine's idea, is the critical community oriented idea. This is the scenario we are trying to envision. This is the situation. I will not say utopian, possibly. If it is utopian, then we should not be here. I think we have to move towards that. And critical community oriented idea is that we can develop a relationship of care and community, can foster solidarity and equal respect and dignity. So something very common about quality, and where we are all gelling together, working together, have developed an understanding for each other and very concerned for each other. And this third dimension, what Elaine is saying, communitarian idea, completely rejects the PPP and the private participation. So you can see the gradation in the argument. The causation legitimating the role, the conditional, it is putting a question mark, conditioning, and the third is the communitarian, where it is rejecting. And here, for education and health, there are two dimensions that I could think of in the morning. One is that what is wrong with private participation in education? There has been a tendency in the Indian case to move from education being broadly defined, inculcation of values, changing the preferences, we are undergoing the transformation, to skill. So the private participation may as well challenge what does education mean. What does a university mean for the society? What does a school mean for the society? Because there is an undergoing, there will be a change. Second, the way the private sector operates, we also undergo a change. And that is a very dangerous for the society. Because when you look at the social disorder and the lack of empathy, lack of concern, you know, whether we are really responsible citizens, we find that this individualization has very much crept into the way we look at ourselves being positioned in the society, and that is really, really problematic. For example, when the private sector would be imposing high fees, you know, as state subsidies are withdrawn or phased out, then the students might think that they're really investors and they would behave investors, very, very individualistic in nature, entrepreneurial nature. That is possibly we're giving more and more emphasis to, but somewhere this positive externalities that we talk about, the interlinkages that we talk about in the society, they get undermined. And the third thing, how can the private sector can hamper this notion of common good? Because something very equal cannot be achieved so easily. Because PPP means in the delivery, it is differentiated. The moment it is differentiated, that this question of equalities to something very equal gets very seriously undermined in the process. Right? So this is what I think we have to look at. Let me end here. And so thank you very much. I'm particularly grateful to Jasmine, Eliza, Linsa, of course, has been of great help in managing everything. And then Kate, we met him, you know, and then Mari, who has been with us. For being here, I wish I could organize in JNU, but because of something, it's taking much time to really get the, you know, the workshop could have been in JNU, but I'm happy that Pranjal took the plunge.